find you for over a year. It's an honor to meet the Wolverine.
That's not who I am anymore. For many years, I have wanted to thank you for saving my life. But I didn't send for you only to thank you, Logan. I wanted to repay you. A gift to equal the life you gave me. You have struggled long enough. I can end your eternity. Make you mortal.
Fun time.
Welcome to the Marvel Cinematic University. I am your professor, Mario Rivera, and joining me in my marvelous doctoral student, ClycloneMC, who has the bachelor's in the MCU, a master's in the multiverse, and is going for their dissertation in Marvel studies. Sly, how are you doing today?
I am doing well. I'm, you know, very excited to be here with you. It's been a hot minute, but we're back at it, and we're talking about a film.
Wow, okay. That's how the energy starts, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking. Of course, this week, we're going back to our favorite franchise, the X-Men universe, Fox's X-Men universe, with The Wolverine. We're back. Sequel time. 2013's The Wolverine. Of course, jumping into our first class. This is a history class where we talk about some little facts here. And of course, this movie is directed by James Mangold, who is responsible for 3:10 to Yuma, Logan, and this movie. So enjoy that. If you like his history, he's also doing the next Indiana Jones film, which I'm very excited about. So
interesting.
We shall see. We shall see. I'm curious how I have a vibe. I'm feeling a vibe from you, Sly. I'm curious how you're going to feel about the next movie in this saga of Logan. So we'll see. We'll see. As I think that one will turn you around. But ultimately, yes, this movie is written by Mark Bombach, Scott Frank. The studio is still Fox Studios. They still have full ownership of the mutants at this time. The movie stars Hugh Jackman. I almost got his name messed up because I've been saying Hugh. I've been saying Hugh a lot for the last 24 hours, so I've been saying that. It also stars Hiroyuki Sanda, Tao Okamoto, Rila Fukushima, and Funke Jansen, Will Yoon Lee. This is, of course, available on, you would think, Disney Plus, which is what I remembered watching it on, but I, in fact, watched on Hulu Plus. It is also, apparently, for the last 2 hours, is now on HBO Max, so please, you can enjoy it on that platform.
Who knows by the time this episode comes out?
That is fair. That is fair, because at one point when we did the Tobey Maguire movies, they were on Peacock, and they are no longer there, so you can't find them there anymore. Yeah. But Sly, can you please tell us the plot to The Wolverine?
All right. In modern-day Japan, Wolverine is out of his depth in an unknown world as he faces his ultimate nemesis. That is a questionable title. In a life-or-death battle that will leave him forever changed, vulnerable for the first time, and pushed to his physical and emotional limits. All right. He confronts not only lethal samurai steel, but also his inner struggle against his own near immortality, emerging more powerful than we have ever seen him before. Of course, I don't read these plots before. I quit life with you.
Yes, so I looked up
choices.
So this wasn't it wasn't user submitted. This, of course, came from, in fact, 21st Century Fox themselves. So this is how they described the movie. Yeah, so they described the movie in this way. Yeah. of course, the only characters that I recognized off the bat were Wolverine is obviously the main character, and then Silver Samurai is the other character. Yukiko is also an X-Men character. Yeah, I'm sure these are characters from the Frank Miller comic book that this is semi-based on, but I'm not so familiar with it that I would say that I know them as, like, important characters in the MCU.
The one that I was going to ask about was Viper, the Doctor. That felt like a comic-ass character.
I'm sure they are, but I've never heard of them until this movie, and I still don't know why they're in this movie.
Fair enough.
Like, it's such a random villain.
Who knows?
Yeah, so I'm looking at the picture now. Yeah, it's created by Jim Steranko. It was, of course, oh my God, it says significant other. Do you know, can you guess who their significant other is? Wolverine.
They were really
married to Wolverine at one point. Oh my God.
All right.
Yeah.
That's a choice.
That's a choice. Their team affiliations, of course, have been the Hellfire Club, the Hand, Madripoor, Hydra, and some other people. But yeah, I don't know if this is the same Viper, but that's the 616. She's all green. She looks like a bodybuilder. I don't know.
All right.
They're included in this movie for the little part that they have into it. But anyways, we're going to go ahead and move on to the grander discussion so we can actually dive deep into yet another X-Men film in our Stanley seminar, where I get to ask Sly a question. Sly, what did you think of the Wolverine?
It was something. It wasn't bad, but it wasn't good, if that makes sense. This was the one that you were talking about had the like release with the non-CGI whole.
No, that was the other one. That was the other one.
That was the other one.
Yeah, the other one. Yeah.
Right. Okay. That makes a lot more sense. For some reason, I had that connected to this one, and I was like, I don't really see it. Anyways, it was 2 hours, and we all know I love a tight 90, so it felt a little, you know, if it was 30 minutes shorter, I think I would have enjoyed it a lot more. But like I said to you while we were chatting before this episode, it felt so generic. Like, the plot was so predictable. It just, like, hit all those, like, trope beats of an act one, an act two, an act three. It felt like it was just trying to be a film and not necessarily a film with a specific direction.
Sure. I could say that. Yeah. I think the way that you described it in that way is probably why I think it succeeds the most, because we've come from some pretty bad X-Men movies. I think in terms of like, okay, we've covered, of course, the original three movies. And by the end of those three movies, I think it got pretty bad. Then I think we did Wolverine right after that, and it got worse. It got pretty bad. Mm-hmm. We then got a bump up with, of course, First Class, where we kind of returning back to the roots, I would say, of enjoyment. Big fan, right? I think we even said that we probably liked it even more than the first one. This to me is at least continuing in that lineage of, oh, okay, I understand majority of the character motivations. I understand where Wolverine is as a character in this one. He's not, you know, he's definitely dealing with stuff that I cared about in the last series. So therefore, I'm like, I think I give this more of like, hey, thank you for being able to make a competent Wolverine movie, given the fact that we had, obviously, the train wreck that, to me, is X-Men Origins. And I feel like that's pretty much me giving it a pass. There are some really cool action scenes in this movie, specifically the train. Mm-hmm. The bullet train is probably my favorite thing that I've seen in a long, long time. The third act has a ton of problems of what they decide to go with that I think are just not interesting. But I do think that the character of Logan at least is explored and how his how it is to be an immortal person that can't basically die and has to deal with all that pain that he has gone through all his entire life. That to me is actually the stuff that I really enjoyed about the movie. But overall, there are things. This is, of course, based on a very classic story of Wolverine going into Japan. Very much fits in that same like Ronin sense of someone from an outside land coming in and then interjecting into this world. But yeah, overall, I do enjoy this movie, but it's a slow bar. It's a low bar, to be honest.
As you were saying that, and I was thinking back to the previous appearances we have seen, I went, oh, right, this was a safe choice. This is them looking at what had come before and go, we need a safe movie. And it shows. But, you know, that's what they needed at the time. I will say, the other, like, kind of gripe I had with this movie is Wolverine's the least interesting character in this entire movie.
That is fair.
Everybody else is more dynamic, more engaging. And I was like, he's just there to be the reason, like, the plot moves along.
Yeah.
And it's, like, he's the titular character. Like, he should be the driving force, the emotional connection. But I was like, I want to know, like, about all these other moments, and we're just getting this one story focused around Logan. And, you know, when you're next to really interesting and intriguing characters, it kind of brings your appearance down a little bit.
And what I also think that makes them interesting, and to go into it a little more, yes, of course, the plot of this is essentially Wolverine during his time during World War II. Help the soldier survive basically the Hiroshima bomb, and it changed, like, this whole future of this person becoming, like, a big millionaire, a billionaire, basically tech company, and this whole time had this, like, fascination with Wolverine. And then in the meantime, we catch up with
Before we get flamed on the internet, it was the Nagasaki bombing.
My bad. Thank you so much. With that,
I just don't want to get flamed on the internet.
No, even I was unclear, to be honest with you. So thank you for clearing that up. But ultimately, then basically the movie's about the aftermath of Last Stand, where Wolverine, and he just sort of, like, is kind of done with it and wants to die, but he can't because that's his thing. And the whole thing is this man trying to give Wolverine a gift by allowing to take away his immortality because he actually wants to continue living. I find that to be the interesting story because it's not about mutants. It's really about these human characters and their conflict with their family. And it's these different rivals with Yakuza and this other clan. And that, to me, you're right, is the more interesting movie that I would rather watch than something with a mutant in it. This just so happens to have Wolverine show up. You know, it's sort of almost by happenstance. But yeah, funny enough, one of my favorite video game series is, of course, the game Yakuza. It is basically all of this, but in even, like, just absolutely 11th degree. So, Sly, I would recommend just play Yakuza if you want more stories like this. It's literally the same thing, and it's awesome.
Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah. In terms of some of the characters that are introduced to this, like I said, all human, for the most part, all human characters. There's two other mutants probably in this movie. Who are some of the standouts that you pretty much enjoyed? Because there's Yukiko, Mariku.
Not down anybody's names. Yukio.
Yeah.
Was the other mutant.
Yes.
And she was really cool. Very badass. I loved everything we got from her. The sister, her quote-unquote sister.
Yeah, Mariko.
Mariko?
Yes.
Yeah. She was great. I loved their dynamic. I loved their interactions. And, you know, how they sprinkled their, like, backstory throughout the film, I thought was really well done.
Yeah.
That was probably the most compelling, like, relation within that story. I think that the archer dude, what was it, Harada?
Harada, yeah.
His storyline was kind of cheapened by the third act.
Yeah, and I'll get into that specifically. I feel like all the male characters in this sort of, like, family all get some weird short shrift in the story and just sort of just there, just to interact with the plot. There's him. There's also the father. There's also the husband to be is also in there. That's also sort of there for background purposes. Again, we're thinking about them, even though this is called The Wolverine. scene, but that's just because we're kind of like interested in their machinations of lives of like, how does this society work with like, you know, their connection to this clan of ninjas. And then there's the Yakuza and there's a power struggle. These are all things I'd watch Game of Thrones for, or Succession.
And the fiance was like a minister of justice or yes. whatever.
Yeah.
Whatever his position was.
Yeah.
Yeah, the politics were also very interesting, which leads me back to this not really feeling like a superhero movie.
Yes.
Which means I thought people died way more often than they did. There are so many times where I wrote in like my notes that like I thought somebody had died. The dad, when he got stabbed
yeah.
with the
yeah.
poison, and then he came back and I was like, all right. Okay, I guess. When Dr. Viper Lady fell off before she like shed her skin, I was yeah. like, all right, okay.
Does she have to do that every time too? That's weird.
Ooh. Yeah. The one death that I did not think was a real death was the grandpa at the funeral. I was like, oh, he's coming back. So like the one death they tried to give me of, they failed, but all the others got me.
That's hilarious. I love that immediately. The one death that is clearly like, oh, that's the red herring, he's not actually dead. You're like, I know, I've seen this story before. It ain't gonna happen. There's no fucking way. To me, I think that the weirdest death for me was, I think Harada dies, if I'm not mistaken. He's like,
yeah, at the very end.
It's so weird.
The flamey sword thing.
Yeah, and he also gets spit in the face by Viper, and he's like scarred for the rest. He's no longer like super cute looking, which was a bummer. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'm going to try and put it back to Wolverine because this is about him. Where do you feel that this the way that the drama foretold his story, basically, after Last Stand, were you happy that this was a continuation story? Or was it something that you're like, you know what, you know, where did you feel that they left off with Logan at the end of this movie?
I thought it was a really interesting emotional arc for him to go through.
Yeah.
That was really should have been the A plot of the movie, was his emotional growth, but it felt more like a B or a C plot.
Sure.
But that, you know, a traumatic loss and then how he deals with it by running away, and then him like grappling with being faced with this man who like wants so desperately to live and like thinks he's taking advantage of his immortality or whatever led to a really interesting like growth by the end of it, him kind of being in an acceptance place, where we see the parallel scene from the opening to the closing. I thought that was really well done. I am weirded out that 2 years later, his claws are still the bones.
Yeah.
I have a lot of questions about that. I don't know if I want answers or not, but the fact that like the adamantium was like around his entire like skeletal system, but doesn't regrow when he regrows bones. I just have a lot of questions.
That brings us, let me see if this transition works. Let's see. All right, cool. All right, this takes us back to the X-Men timeline. Okay, so I'm gonna add that to this picture, and then on Twitter you should hopefully see an updated version. But basically, so this takes place after Last Stand, right? This is probably like maybe a couple years. And in this moment, yes, you're right. We know that Wolverine has metal claws. In this movie, he gets them cut off. And then he has bone claws at the end of the film, which is really weird. Keep an eye on that for the next one.
Oh, no.
Because I think they forget about it.
Oh, even better. Because the mid-credit scene is the 2 years later.
Yes.
Spoiler alert, Charles.
Charles Xavier.
And he has the bone claws.
Yeah.
And I was like, ooh, all right,
That's a choice.
Yeah, because I'm immediately remembering a plot point in the next one. I'm like, yeah, they definitely forgot about that. So we'll see. We'll see when we talk about that one. But yeah, yes. Interesting journey for Logan for sure coming up. Overall, I think the emotional core of this movie was there was not enough of the bear, which happens at the very beginning.
Bear.
Yeah. Such a sweet bear.
Oh, that bear. R.I.P.
Yeah, rest in peace.
yeah. That was... What a, like, devastating way to start this film was him just, like, being, like, caveman, whatever.
Caveman Logan? Yeah.
And then getting this, like, really, like, sad hunter story with the bear.
yeah.
And then immediately Yukio shows up and we're like, we're going to Tokyo.
Because if you just take this movie and then just pretend for a second that Wolverine is Peter Robbins and that bear is Pooh Bear and it's just like a rated R version and these hunters take out Pooh Bear.
Speaking of ratings though, we did get a fuck word.
Yes, you get one fuck in this one, which by the way, there's an R rated cut of this movie, if I'm not mistaken. And I remember that was the first time I ever saw it. There is a lot of blood. a lot of blood in that one. So, of course, by the time we get Logan, they decided we're going full rated R. And so it gets even crazier once we get to that one specifically. But yeah, we do get the fuck, which of course is hilarious whenever Logan gets to say it.
Very good.
I have this one. What were your thoughts on the use of all the Jean Grey stuff as a character that we've kind of gotten to know a little bit, obviously in the third one and becoming the villain of the third movie?
Yeah. I think it would have been more powerful if it was him hearing multiple voices and sure. not just Jean.
Yeah.
We did get one moment where I was very excited. We got a brief Kayla audio clip.
Yeah.
And that was really exciting. I think it would have been way more interesting if we got like all of the people he had lost in the past however movies. But overall, the idea of having, you know, being haunted by the ghost of the person you feel like you killed, I think emotionally it really worked for the story.
No, for sure. I think as like a ghost that constantly attacks basically Logan throughout the movie, it's like, I think even at the very end it's still unsettling as something that he just has to accept. It's just sort of this ghost that he has, but I'm happy to see that character come back. And I thought after First Class we wouldn't be able to see any of the old X-Men characters, and I forget that I still have a fondness for those, and this show has definitely opened that up where I do care more about the original movies than I think I do. So that was very nice. I don't know. Like you said, there's not a whole lot to explore in this story other than it's simply just it's a quest log for Logan to go to Japan and take care of this character and fall in love, and they go to different places before she's eventually caught, and then he has to rescue her in a tower. Like, literally, that's every movie you've ever seen. It's literally the plot to the Super Mario Brothers video game. So it's there's not a whole lot going on. I guess to really emphasize is just like it was a story that they wanted to tell because it was something in the comics. It works, right? It's just the best way to describe it. I think we will get into far more interesting territory once we get to Days of Future Past and Logan. Those are the ones that I'm honestly most excited to revisit because those are the ones I think more fondly of when I think about these characters. But yeah, I don't know. Any really major thoughts? I think this is gonna be a quick episode. I don't know.
I will say shout out to the vet student that patches Logan up in the Love Hotel. I thought that was really funny. That piece got me. And then another note I made that I think we'll get a chuckle out of you, Mario.
Okay,
is at the very end. Yoshida gets thrown out of the tower or whatever.
Yes.
And I wrote, Yoshida went out Bucky style.
Yeah, except Bucky didn't land in a pool. He landed down a ravine or something.
No, not the pool dude.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. You're right. Grandpa. You're right. The grandpa did get a Bucky moment. You're absolutely right. We'll see him in 75 years.
It was falling into the snow.
You're right.
We never really see the body.
Yes.
That one got
a lot of people get thrown from buildings in this movie, so that's why I got confused. But yeah, you're right.
There was a lot of building throwing. There was some train throwing. Mm-hmm. Lots of people getting thrown to the perils.
Yeah, for sure. And it's funny. With this one specifically, even though the whole plot is like Logan starts losing his immortality, I still was like, there's nothing bad's gonna happen to Logan. Like, they don't do nearly enough to really push that plot. I will say,
He technically dies. So.
He technically dies. The scene where he like has to like pull the thing out of his heart was like kind of really gross. Even to visually think about it, I don't think they don't put that in the R-rated version, because that's still kind of like, that's still pretty messed up as a concept. But yeah.
The shot right after that scene, so he rips the thing off of his heart and his heart stops and his hand falls and it's like covered in blood.
Yeah.
I was like, ah, chef's kiss. What a beautiful shot.
It's funny, actually, funny you say that. I believe there is a moment where he talks to Yukiko, and was that before or after that? Because that scene specifically about the way she describes how he dies, she sort of tells him, like, I see you die with your heart in your hand. Is that kind of the reference there, I guess? Because,
yeah.
Okay.
So
yeah, okay.
We see that before he goes into the building or whatever, when
yes,
they're in the car.
That's right.
She's, like, describing how her powers work.
Yeah.
She's like, it's like looking through a keyhole, and she sees him die with his heart in his hand.
Yeah.
And then you see later the shot where he's holding the thing that was on his
interesting
heart
in okay
his hand when his heart stops.
I will say, Sly, put a bookmark. Just put a bookmark on that wording.
All right.
Just think about it later when we do the rest of this podcast. But because a lot of people, yeah, that's interesting. Okay, so.
Very interesting.
I guess
have one question that you probably won't answer. I really hope Yukio comes back. I really enjoyed her.
I'll spoil that. I'm gonna say yes, but not in the way you think. So,
great.
If we know anything,
no idea what you mean by that.
If we know anything about the X-Men universe, they're very inconsistent. So. we'll see in a minute. We'll see many movies from now. Let's talk about the villains, and then I think we can move on. Viper, again, we already kind of joked about it. Kind of needless, other than just to have another mutant character that is a part of the plot that stops him from having powers. That it could have literally been anybody.
Put together that she was the recording lady.
Yeah.
Until way too late, I was like, oh. Mm-hmm. They're both blonde. I should have known. She was cool. I thought her powers were interesting.
Yeah.
I thought she was not at all a compelling antagonist at all.
Especially when she starts shedding.
The shedding was a little bit funny. I thought that was a good moment.
Yeah. Again, could have took it or leave it. Again, as a character, I had no idea who it was, so yeah. Because so much of the story is like, it's Wolverine's the only one that has powers, but at a certain point he gets depowered, and so he has to be careful. I think that's what makes the story a little bit interesting. But then to have another mutant there honestly didn't add a whole lot to me. The other villain, of course, the Silver Samurai, which gets introduced super late in the movie. What did you think of the grandfather coming back as a giant samurai?
Oh, the grandfather. I thought you were talking about the when the dad puts on the suit that was
does he
at
put on a
the
suit?
Funeral.
He does? Oh, yes. The other, yeah. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
He puts it on during that fight, which is a great fight, by the way. Him taking on Logan, I thought was really cool. But ultimately, no, I'm talking about the grandfather in the giant neck armor.
The fucking kaiju robot ass
yeah.
It was something. Like, as soon as we saw the, like, diagrams or whatever, I was like, ah, the grandfather's gonna come back in the mech suit, whatever. All right. So, like, the predictability was, like, whatever. But, like, it's a giant fucking robot. That's pretty cool. I don't know what else to tell you.
Hey, so far we haven't gotten the promise of giant fucking robots other than in the danger room of the third movie. They tease like the Sentinels, which of course is giant ass mutant killers. So yeah, the fact that we had Wolverine semi-fight a giant mech is kind of cool. I did like the effect of like him going from the older version of him and then slowly turning into back to the younger version of him by taking over the powers,
sucking the
literal life out
of Logan's claw.
Straight up, man.
It was something.
Yeah,
it was a choice.
Yeah, and then ultimately, yeah, he goes over the cliff. But yeah, and then of course, Bucky style. And then Wolverine goes on a plane. And then we see him again 2 years later at a different station, at a plane station for some reason. That was a choice. And then that sets up, of course, our next movie that we'll be doing in the X-Men series, of course, Days of Future Past. So, kick excited.
And that's the one where the timeline gets real wonky, right?
So, I'll say, in my opinion, it was when they were like, oh, cool, we fixed the timeline.
Oh,
it was like, hey, we did it. And then after that, they're like, fuck it. And then they just go even further out the fucking window. But,
oh man. All right. I can't wait. I can't wait to get there.
Who knows? And then, by the way, we're recording our episodes out of order. As of right now, Deadpool 3 has been announced. Have you seen any of this, by the way?
Yeah. I saw you sent the tweet.
That's right.
That's something.
That is something. We'll be talking about. We'll be talking about that at another time. But yeah.
Oh yeah.
For sure. Okay, I think that pretty much closes up our summer. I mean, ultimately, did you? No, we'll save that to the end. I'll save that to the end in terms of what we influence. But we're gonna go ahead and move on to our next class, drama class, where we do some scenes from this movie. Now, Sly, you picked these scenes. You tell me who you want me to be. Who do you want to be?
Oh man. I want you to do Logan for the first one.
All right.
You're a soldier, and you seek out what all soldiers do.
And what's that?
An honorable death. An end to your pain.
Who says I'm in pain?
A man who has nightmares every night of his life is in pain. So true, bestie. So true.
Snap fingers. You can say that literally about any millennial. Especially because you're
a little too close to home there, my dude.
It hurt. It kind of hurts. Honestly, I'm not gonna lie to you. This next one's good. Do you want to do Logan or do you want to do Yukiko?
You can do Yukiko for this one.
Okay. How did you know there was a pool down there?
I didn't. Just walks away. Casually tosses a freaking...
When it happens, though, you think...
Political figure out of a window.
Yeah, he does throw a political figure out of a window, which is kind of cool. Because when it happens, you don't know about the pool, it's kind of cool. Yeah. He just, like, tosses this,
it's
like...
a real cool shot.
This adult... This dude is cheating on Mirko at the time. No, 100%. I thought it was pretty cool. Which, of course, 100% deserved it. Which is a reference, of course, to a 007 movie. So that's what they did in that one. And then for this one, do you want to be Jean Grey?
Sure.
Okay.
This is the mirror to the opening. This is the closing scene with Jean.
Yeah.
Where she goes, can you stay?
I can't.
Yes, you can. This is what you wanted.
Not anymore.
I'm all alone here. You put me here.
You are hurting people, Jean. I had to. I love you, Jean. I always will.
My heart.
Meanwhile, Scott is also in heaven like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Man.
Shout out to Scott Summers.
Every love triangle would be better if it ends in a triad, and I stand by that.
There has to be a movie one day where they're just like, fuck it, why don't all three of us just date each other? It's like, okay.
Logan and Scott were eye fucking each other the entire time, and I stand by that.
100%. I can see through these glasses. I understood. All right, we're gonna go ahead and move over. We're gonna move over to quiz time. Of course, normally we would do music time, but there was no music in this other than the score. Score's good, but nothing to write home about.
Yeah,
that's fine. Whatever. But please find our playlist over, of course, at Spotify and Apple Music, where we have some of the bangers from our previous movies. So please check those out. We're gonna go right into quiz time, where we, of course, I do a pop quiz for Sly, and Sly has to answer these questions. These questions are my favorite ones that we've done so far. There's a theme. But before I get to the ones I like, of course, the number one question is Stan Lee in this movie?
I don't think so. I tried to think of it, and the only time he could possibly have shown up was in the airport in the mid-credits. But I didn't see him there, so I'm going to go with no, he was not in this
movie. So, this movie was shot in 17 weeks, I believe. Majority of it was actually shot in Australia, which is not what you would think for a movie set in Japan. Japan was 4 weeks of shooting. So, you know, a person in his age, I think he was like in his, or I want to say his early 90s. His early 90s or mid 90s, he was not traveling that far. So, of course, he was probably not in the movie for that reason, because that was a reason given before. All right, to the questions that I'm very excited. So, you get a point for that one, of course. The next question, though, is Hugh Jackman wanted to look as ripped as possible for this film, which, of course, involved the dehydration diet, which is apparently a bodybuilding diet, where he didn't ingest any liquids. For how many hours? A, 10 hours. B, 15 hours. C, 22 hours. And D, 36 hours. This man didn't drink something. Yeah.
I just gotta say, one of my notes was legitimately, those veins are really veiny.
Yes.
And so, like, it showed. I was like, oh man, that man is dehydrated. So with that in mind, I'm going to go for the most extreme answer we have here, which was what, 36?
Yes,
because that man looked like he did not have an ounce of water in his body.
It is in fact 36 hours. This man went almost 2 days without water.
I was wrong.
He almost went 2 days without water just so he could look as ripped as this man's ever looked. If you look at comparison shots, because a lot of people are talking about Wolverine this week, I've seen a comparison shot of what he looked like in the first movie in comparison to what he looks like in this one, and there is a significant difference. So, yeah, shout out for him for being A, crazy, and also probably really thirsty. So, good for him. Good for him.
And probably really dizzy.
Super dizzy. Like, he also has to scream in this role. He has to, like, go do this like a like, oh my God, he would pass out. I don't understand how he could have done it. But this is maybe how he did it. Third question. Hugh Jackman asked this action star for food advice on how to bulk up for the role, which involved a lot of rice and a lot of chicken. Okay. Which action star was it? Was it A, Ryan Reynolds? B, The Rock? C, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and D, Chris Pratt.
Okay. We're going process of elimination here.
Okay. I'm
immediately eliminating Chris Pratt
and okay.
Ryan Reynolds. I don't think they're the type to be where Hugh Jackman is getting advice from. which leaves Arnold Schwarzenegger and The Rock. Listen, I feel like I've heard a lot about rice and chicken in relation to The Rock. I don't know why. That just, like, feels right in my gut. So I'm going with The Rock.
It is, in fact, The Rock.
Right.
You all are right. 100%. That's right. You got all three. It is, in fact, The Rock. Hugh Jackman, of course, had a conversation with him. And yes, rice and chicken is apparently the go-to in order to bulk up and also get some protein. So that explains why I've been eating a lot of rice and chicken lately. And I can now lift up tables. So there we go. That pretty much explains it.
Good for you.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and wrap this up with some homeroom. We're going to give our final thoughts on the movies. Sly, what are your final thoughts? Do you recommend this movie? Do you think this is, you know, a worthy thing for the timeline of the X-Men films that we've been doing so far? What are your thoughts? What are your final thoughts?
I think this movie absolutely holds up. Mm-hmm. There was nothing that felt like super egregious enough where I was like, that's a choice. Obviously I'm not super educated on the portrayals of Japan and Japanese people in media, so like there could be something that I missed, but it didn't feel particularly disrespectful overall. I think it's absolutely still worth watching. If you're going through them, you might as well. I don't think it's a movie I would go out of my way to watch again, but it comparatively pretty good, pretty solid. It holds up. It's not something I would say to skip if you're going through at all, but I wouldn't say go watch this movie immediately. Like, you have to have seen it by any means.
Yeah, I would say that's pretty fair overall. I think what definitely gives this movie the leg up was that it was the second movie to come out. I mean, it was the first movie to come out after First Class that came out. And people were kind of like, hey, you know, X-Men movies are doing pretty well. Of course, everyone remembered the last one and have those sort of harsh feelings of the Wolverine. And so this coming to being just like, hey, it's pretty just a standard movie going through all the way with that amazing tease at the end that's setting up this return of these characters, which I don't think they announced the name of the movie that was coming on after this, or if they did, we didn't know that this would be the tease for that. And I think that ultimately added to the hype going back into X-Men while the MCU is now coming out at its full heights. I mean, now we're at 2013 with this one. So this is post, if I'm not mistaken, Avengers.
First Avenger.
Yeah.
Because Avengers was 2012, right?
Yeah, 2012. So yeah. We are already like having this, you know, superhero movie revolution happening over there at Marvel Studios. And, you know, the X-Men movies are just trying to compete and be on that same level. And I think that them setting this up really added a lot of hype at the time for X-Men films. I that's why I think a lot of the praise comes from this. Now, as a standalone, it's not going to blow your skirt up. It's not going to, you know, out of all the movies that we talked about, I still would rather you see the Hulk. I still think you'd rather, hell, even see Daredevil, to be honest with you. I had a fun time with Daredevil. mostly for Colin Farrell. But yeah, I still think that this is a solid movie overall. Is it something you need to like leap out and see right away? No, definitely not. Watch First Class several times. First Class is a blast. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that's pretty much going to do it. Your homework, of course, is you're watching. We're back into the Andrew Garfield verse, The Amazing Spider-Man 2 with special guest.
Special guest.
That's right.
Yeah. Very exciting.
Yes. Yes. So definitely please check this out. Sly, where can people find you on the internet?
You can find me everywhere at ClycloneMC. You can also catch me on Thirsty Thursdays on TikTok Live talking about 911. And you can catch me on Point in Progress. And we'll throw the After Party at After Party Show on TikTok, Instagram, and Twitter. I remember what platforms we're on. And I also want to say from now on,
yeah,
we have guest after guest lined up. It's going to be a guest-filled spectacular for a next decent solid chunk.
Yeah.
Which is very exciting.
No, of course. So definitely check out for all that and follow everyone that comes on the show. Of course, you can follow me at that Mario Rivera. I now have that Twitter handle back. You can also find me over there at the Point in Progress podcast, where we do things sometimes. That is a joke for the future. So in the meantime, please follow us over there at youtube.com/pointinprogress. This has, of course, been the MC University, and today class is dismissed. Goodbye.
They did to me what I am can't be undone. Don't be so sure. Not healing.